I'm Robert Osborne, and welcome to a very special edition of TCM's Private Screenings. It's a conversation with Liza Minnelli, talking about what it was like for her growing up in Hollywood, being the daughter of a celebrated father, film director Vincent Minnelli, and legendary mother Judy Garland. It's about having neighbors like Humphrey Bogart and Lauren Bacall and hanging out after school watching Gene Kelly hoofing on a soundstage. We talk about the influence all of them had on her, especially her parents. Now, Liza's somebody I've known for a long time, somebody I've always respected. She's warm, intelligent, delightful to be around, certainly talented, and very, very funny. She's not the person I've read about in so many headlines through the years. It's because of that I've always wanted to be able to sit down with her and talk to her with cameras rolling so people who don't know her see the Liza that her friends have always known and adored, and that finally happened. We bring you that conversation right now. So join me for Private Screenings, Liza Minnelli.
A sudden whisper, that sweet refrain, in every thought of you. The gentle flicker of light proclaims our only lasting proof. Smoky places where memories drift sweetly out of tune. The every thought of you.
Thank you so much for being here. We've been after this for a long, long time.
Well, I know.
Yes.
Well, we sat together at dinner so often, made each other laugh so hard.
And we always wanted to do this.
I know.
So thank you for doing it. I know you're not somebody that has a lot of nostalgia in your life or looking backwards. You're very much a today person.
Yes.
But you have a perspective about the world of TCM better than anybody because you, grew up at MGM. Your father was a great director there. Your mother, mm-hmm. a great star there. Mm-hmm. So we do ask you to go back a little bit with us to
sure.
just talk about that. What was that like? Do you remember your first impression of being at MGM?
Well, it was my playground. You know, like most kids, you went to school, and then sometimes you went to the playground. Now, I just went to MGM.
Sure.
And I knew every inch of MGM. You know, I knew where the costume department was, and where they made this and that, and all the makeup department, and everybody. I sat with my father on the boom, or up top with him. I knew my way around a set, like so many kids in Hollywood. I used to always go to where they did the dances.
Mm-hmm.
I loved watching the choreography.
You were attracted to that at the very beginning.
Oh, yeah, I loved that, yeah.
Now, you made your movie debut, I think, at the age of two or three in the good old summertime. Do you remember that experience, or was that too far back to remember when you did that?
No, I remember, because I got all dressed up, and I had a parasol. And they remembered everything I should wear. It was very detailed. But they didn't put any panties on me.
Mm-hmm.
And all I remember is Van Johnson's hand on my butt. And if you look at my face next time you see the movie, I'm going... Just a little strange. Just vaguely uncomfortable.
Now, were you attracted to, you'd become such a great star in your own right. Were you attracted to the show business aspect of it from a young age?
Oh, no, not at all.
Not at all?
No, I wanted to be an ice skater.
Really?
Well,
what started
because
that?
Because it was so slow
uh-huh.
making movies. It was an industry town. You were on schedule. Your parents got up, had breakfast, and went to work. They came home at a certain time. You know, when you were younger, you had dinner before them. They kissed you goodnight. And it was very, very organized. So it wasn't anything that was glamorous. It was just organized.
Do you recall, because you were a kid, but did they talk show business a lot? Or was
oh, no.
other things they were talking about?
No. When they came home, the last thing they talked about was show business. Mm-hmm. It was a day's work.
Were you aware from a young age what hard work that was? That they, how hard they worked?
Oh, yes. Because I spent so much time there.
Yeah.
You know, and it wasn't just they did something and then moved on.
Mm-hmm.
It was take after take. You know, first it was the main angle, and then the medium shot, and then the close-ups, and then the over-the-shoulder shots. And it was, I thought it was so slow. It's just slow.
Right. At what point did you really realize that you're... parents were famous? I mean, you were famous from the time you were born, so you kind of grew up with that.
Everybody's parents were famous where I grew up.
Yeah.
Everybody, you know?
So you were just used to that as part of the world you lived in.
You know, we lived next door to Humphrey Bogart and Betty McCall. And Sammy Kahn lived across the street, and Lana Turner lived over here. And it was an industry town. So... I didn't realize it until I moved away.
Mm-hmm.
Then I remember when I came back, I thought, oh my God, look at this. It was like 3 years. Look at these houses. Gee, many Christmas. This is so luxurious. I grew up here. I was living in a really small apartment.
Mm-hmm. In New York.
Yeah, and that's... It really threw me.
When did it kick in, though, about maybe being an actress in the theater? Take us a little from the ice skating to Best Foot Forward off Broadway.
My parents took me to see Bye Bye Birdie on Broadway. And I thought, oh, maybe that's what I want to do.
Because that had a lot of kids in it.
Yeah. Yeah. And it was fascinating.
Yeah.
And they looked like they were so happy.
Yeah.
And it just looked great. I said, yeah, I think I'll do that. So I started, you know, conning my parents into letting me go into New York.
What did they think about that? I mean, were they encouraging about that or not?
No. They said, well, you can go for a summer and study. So they let me stay with a friend of theirs. And, I got a job. So I said, well, I got a job, so I don't have to come home, right? And they said, well, I said, that's what you said. They said, well, right. So I stayed in the Barbizon Hotel for Women, and I just kept getting more jobs. And I loved the live theater. So I went to acting school and dance schools and this, that, anything I could learn, I wanted to learn. I did summer stock. I moved scenery. I mean, I started at the bottom, and I never took another cent from my parents. I wanted them to be proud of me.
When did you know you had the talent to do that?
I always knew it.
Did you?
Yeah. I just wanted to learn. You know, and I think that comes from my father. Yeah, you know? And of course my mother, yes. But my father instilled it in me.
Did your dad, being a great director, ever give you any advice about acting?
Oh, yeah. He gave me the greatest advice I've ever heard. I came home one day, and I'd gotten a job in a show at school. Right? I got to play Mary.
Very young.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Okay.
It's in kindergarten.
Okay.
And I got to play Mary, right? And I dropped the baby. It was not a good thing. And anyway.
It's a bad sign for Mary. Yeah.
Oops. I mean, what are you going to say? But I said, Daddy, what is acting? He's trying to cheer me up. He said, I don't know. Later that evening, he came in when he tucked me in. He said, I've been thinking about your question, and I think acting is hearing something for the first time and saying something for the first time. That's the best description ever heard.
Yeah, very good. Absolutely.
Yeah.
And your dad, besides being, you know, the great director we know him to be, was also a great scenic designer and everything in New York, Radio City Music Hall, I believe.
Oh, yes.
And the theater before he went to Hollywood.
Right, well, in the Chicago theater. He did the scenery, the costumes, right?
Mm-hmm.
He started when he was 15.
Wow.
Yeah. And then he did Radio City Music Hall. And he ended up producing, which is everything, choreographing, the scenes, the stage, everything. He did that for a long time. And he didn't want to go to Hollywood. But they conned him into it.
Who was it that conned him in?
It was MGM. It was Arthur Freed.
Mm-hmm.
And he went out there and they said, do whatever you want. He said, I'm going to learn for a year. And then finally, at the end of the year, they said, what do you want to do? And he said, an all-black musical. And he did a wonderful, wonderful movie, which you and I talk about all the time.
Yeah, Cabin in the Sky.
Absolutely.
There's honey in the honeycomb. There's sugar in the cane.
It was the first chic black film.
And one of the last for a long time, too.
Yes.
Well, I think one of the great things that he did that he never gets credit for, because it's not given the screen credit, is that wonderful moment in Strike Up the Band, where he has this sequence with the fruit on a table turned into an orchestra.
Yes.
I think that song is Our Love Affair.
Yes.
It just shows the genius right there of how his mind worked and the creativity there.
Yeah.
Did you visit his sets a lot?
Oh, it was always on set, yeah.
And what are some of the memories you have of visiting sets?
Was how he would look at the number itself and then figure out how to cover it and not keep cutting.
So it could be done in a continuous shot?
Yes, even if it meant 15 camera movements. Go from here to here, and then we go up, go down, around, and in, and over, down, and back. It was astounding, and nobody had ever seen anything like it.
And also his visual eye for those things. Nobody ever was quite like
because
that.
Because he'd been a designer and a painter. I mean, all of those effects in American in Paris, those weren't done with any of the today's stuff.
Right.
Those were done with lights. It was just amazing, right?
Yeah.
You know.
I also think one of the great moments in film is the Madame Bovary waltz. I mean, that's
he
like...
He was the first one to hang somebody in a basket overhead and do a 360 shot, and then it stops.
Yeah.
Then reverse it.
They didn't have handheld cameras in those days.
No.
And also, you watch that sequence, and it's in like one, as you said, a continuous shot, and you cannot figure out how the camera could get around without wires twisting and all of that.
No, I mean, let's stop, please. I can't breathe. I'm going to faint.
The lady is going to faint.
Break the windows.
Unbelievable.
And then when they break the windows, how neurotic that music is.
Yeah,
it's
Nicholas Rosa, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh. Fabulous.
Yeah, incredible.
Now, did you watch your mother work very often on films?
Oh, sure.
And you remember any particular moments that delighted you as a kid watching being filmed?
Well, I loved watching The Pirate.
Uh-huh.
You know, that was super.
And that was your dad directing it.
Yeah, indeed.
Yeah.
Oh, it was just wonderful, because it took 2 years to make that movie. Because, you know, he wanted it perfect. And he loved photographing Mom. There were sequences where he would just let her roll. He'd say, this is what I'd like to get out of it. I'd like you to be here when we start, go over there, and arrive here. And she'd say, And he said, and do what you do. And she had that big fight with Gene Kelly, where she breaks all the furniture.
Now, Manuel. Now, Manuel. Oh, no, no! You hurt someone!
Perfect. One take. Perfect.
And that captures her humor on film, I think, as well as any movie ever did.
Yes.
You know, her sense of humor.
I shall see you later.
Oh.
this. He won't get away with this. Manuela!
You know, there was a movie called The Clock, which is so brilliant. And Mama didn't like the way it was going. And she said, I want Vincent Minnelli.
And we should also add in here that this is like the first movie she'd ever done where she doesn't sing. This is like a straight dramatic role.
Yes.
So this is a very important film for her.
Huge.
Yeah.
And it wasn't going well. So she said, I want Vincent Minnelli. And they brought him in. And what he did, and she told me was this, was he said, there can't be just two characters. We need a third character. So the third character is going to be the city, New York. And that became such a wonderful idea. And then all of the characters that he put in, like the milkman.
Right.
Like this happening and this happening, you know. And you just bought it.
Mm-hmm.
And there are moments, like, I mean, when they watch those people get married after they'd been married, you know, by a judge who's on his way home.
You husband and wife. May God bless your union. Here, you take this.
Boss, here's the 518 logo.
And then they pass by a church and these people are getting married in a beautiful gown and they're just standing there. It's heartbreaking.
And this is all just one weekend in the life of these two
yes.
people that have just met.
That's it.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a wonderful movie.
And then he recreated that station.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He recreated it. It's just brilliant.
It really is.
The details.
But that's that art yeah. director's eye, too.
Yeah, but that it taught me one thing. The minute somebody says, nobody will notice, no, they will notice. They
right.
will notice.
Right.
You know?
And he did that in an era when movies usually showed in a theater once and disappeared.
Right.
And after 3 years, totally disappeared from
yeah,
everywhere.
No.
So, at least today, you know that movies have a lifespan and they're going
to
be around for a while.
To you.
Well, TCM and DVDs and all that
yes.
sort of thing. But in those days, you know, movies were not expected to last. And the fact that they took the time, somebody like your father took the time to go into that
yes.
detail.
What's interesting about his work, Daddy's work, was my dad was the only director at MGM that did everything. Everybody else just did musicals, or they just did this, or they just did. He did everything from Madame Bovary to Gigi to The Long, Long Trailer to Home from the Hill, which is a movie about hunting. And he goes on location to Paris, Texas. And I go with him. And at one point, they've dressed up some of the outdoor set for him. And he's going, no. He went, this is what I want. And it was Poison Ivy or something. So that slowed down the production for a day. But he was working with George Hamilton, George Peppard, and Mitchum. Okay, with Mitchum, all he had to do was give him the staging. Leave him alone.
Maybe you can arrange to forgive me. Not all at once, just a little bit every day.
Peppard was a method actor, so he had to really work with him.
My mama tied me up with a length of clothesline and said, I'm going to keep you this way till you learn one thing. He don't want you. Keep away. I howled like a dog on the end of that line.
And George Hamilton was a newcomer, so he had to almost give him the line readings because that's what he needed.
I don't want any part of you.
Better have a good reason for talking to me like that, boy.
You mean I'm not showing you enough respect? What makes you think you've got any coming?
So I saw him work with these three different actors and give them what each of them needed to get things done. And I thought that was fascinating.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, it's really fascinating.
Part of the genius of him.
Yeah. And the way he listened and the way he figured it out. He listened.
Mm-hmm. Let's talk about Gene Kelly.
All right. He was great.
And you were very close to him.
Yes. And he and Ira Gershwin and my dad, and there's a whole gang of them, would play pool. Right? And my first Halloween, that was my first or something, my third, that I can remember, I was a witch. And of course, we went down the streets and we got to Uncle Gene's house, and he opened the door and he started to laugh. And I started to cry because I wanted him to be scared. And he went, suddenly went, oh my God, and he got really scared. And I was so pleased. And he clued in all the other people. So when I came in, they all went, oh yeah, it was just wonderful.
Oh,
it was wonderful.
And did you watch him work a lot?
Oh, a lot.
Yeah, and did you learn a lot from him?
Yes, because I watched him rehearse. I watched him work with Sid Charisse, who I loved. I learned so much from her.
And what did you learn from her?
It was just the lines of her body and the way she moved her legs. And again, the dancer's line, you know, she was my favorite.
Did you study dance? Because dancing is a strong suit for you.
Five, six, seven, eight!
I studied with Eugene Loring, who had been a dancer. I still study with Luigi, who was in most of my dad's movies.
Mm-hmm. And once a dancer, always a dancer.
I think so. I mean, watching Fred.
Well, let's talk a little about Fred Astaire.
Oh, my God. He was amazing. You could just take a still of any move he made, and it looked like he had stopped.
Mm-hmm.
And he hadn't. He had gone on. You know, it was just every single movement could have been a still picture. Now, when my father was the only one that could talk them into doing a number together.
With Gene Kelly, Ziegfeld Follies.
Yes, exactly. And nothing happened for 3 weeks. So a lot of people talked, and finally they had to do something. So that's when the number started. And it was interesting, because they both really tried to do things that would flatter them both. And they were generous to each other.
One would always expect they might be rivals or something, but they were great friends.
Yes. They were pros.
Mm-hmm.
In their own way. When Gene danced, you knew it was a great dance number. When Fred danced, you thought he was making it up on the spot.
Yeah, that's a great description of the difference between the two of them.
Thank you.
Let's talk a little about Kate Thompson. Because Kate Thompson, I know, is your godmother, and you devoted a great portion of your Liza at the Palace show that you did to her.
Yeah, the Tony Award-winning show.
Yes, a Tony Award-winning
show.
We won
it, my God, yeah.
And I know she's very important in your life, and most of us know her basically from Funny Face.
Yes.
With Fred Astaire and Audrey Hepburn. But she was a big influence in your life. So tell us a little about why you were so crazy about Kate Thompson.
She was so funny. She was really funny. And it was wit.
Sophisticated wit.
Yeah.
Yes.
Extremely funny. And so sophisticated. And so original.
If I let this go through, I will have failed the American woman.
Oh, no, Miss Prescott, you don't say that.
The great American woman who stands out there naked waiting for me to tell her what to wear.
If you get, you know, Liza's at the Palace.
Sure.
I think you'll see what I'm talking about. Because I don't know how to describe it. You just have to do it, you know?
Hers was one of the great nightclub acts of all time.
Of all
time. With the Williams Brothers.
Yes.
Including Andy Williams.
Yes.
Talked about one of those legendary things which you recreated in your show.
Well.
Which was so terrific.
Yeah.
Well, it was great.
How do you say thank you? I don't know how. You know,
it was great to see it, though, to get an essence of what she was about.
Yeah.
And what it was that made her.
Oh, thank you.
What she was. But she was a big influence on your life in many ways.
Huge.
Right? Did she give you advice about life and about style and things like that? Was she good about that?
She was an example. It was the thing that she'd say quietly, like we were at a dinner party once, and somebody would start the subject, and then everybody would comment on it. And I kept passing, and Kay would pass. So we're just kind of listening to everything. And every time it got around to this certain actor, he'd say, I don't know about, you know, football. I don't know. That acting came up. It went around. And he said, acting. I don't know about acting. And Kate was smoking a cigarette, and she said, and only I could hear, evidently. How do you describe that? Evidently. What? Yeah. Perfect. At one point, I was divorcing somebody, right? And in order to cheer me up, she said, well, she reminded me about the time that she had been divorcing somebody. And she said it had gotten extremely messy. And it took about a year. And at the end of the year, when the final papers arrived, she sent this guy a huge crate of baseballs with a card that said, bats to DiMaggio, dot, 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 dot. And you know, the rest is balls to you. But it was implied, you see. She never.
Sure. Yeah.
Isn't that funny? Yeah.
Why didn't she do more movies?
She didn't like it.
She didn't like the process.
It was too slow. She liked, and she loved doing different things.
Uh-huh.
I mean, look what she did. She was a writer.
Eloise.
Yes. A designer. This, that. She did anything she wanted.
Choreographer,
to do.
Certainly.
Mm-hmm.
Director.
Everything.
And a performer, certainly a great performer.
Oh, yeah.
Singer.
And everybody loved her and respected her.
Back to the MGM days, we talked a lot about your father and going on the sets. Did you go on your mother's sets very often?
Oh, yeah, yeah. All the time.
And what did you learn from her?
How real she was.
You mean how real she could be on camera?
Yes.
Yeah.
It always sounded so real. And I asked her, how come it sounds so real? And she said, because you have to figure out why that person is saying that. And if she wasn't saying just that, what else would she say? I said, Mike, what do you mean? And she was working on a scene for something. She said, okay, you be me. And I was her, and she read and gave me the cues, and I read her part. She said, now don't say those words, but answer the question with different words. I said, all right. And like she'd say, so how are you feeling today? And the answer was fine. And I said, really good. And in other words, she told me, don't say what you're really thinking. Say what you should say. And let everything that you should be thinking go on up here.
In the eyes and all
yeah.
of that. Your mother was always so much better actress than she ever got credit for being.
Oh, she was brilliant.
Yeah, she really was.
Sometimes I hate him. I hate his promises to stop, and then the watching and waiting to see it begin again. I hate to go home to him at night, listen to his lies. Well, my heart goes out to him because he tries. He does try. But I hate him for failing. I hate me, too. I hate me because I failed, too. I have.
She was brilliant. You know, amazing.
Did she ever talk to you about acting once you became an actress?
Not very often. But I can remember her sitting with me for a couple of hours once and talking about it. Then she sent me to Uta Hagen in New York City. who was just a brilliant teacher. What she knew is that if I was even going to try it, she wasn't going to let me get into anybody's hands who wasn't good. And she kept saying, "Are you sure you want to do this?" I said,
well,
yeah.
She'd also, you know, she had a long, long career. I mean,
sure.
A long, hard fight for her career and everything like that. So it'd be natural she wouldn't necessarily want her daughter to be in the business and have to go through that.
But I didn't want that. I wanted to be on Broadway.
Yeah. So when she had problems that she went through and all of that, were you aware of that, or was that kind of kept away from all of you?
Oh, no, I was aware of it.
And did it bother you? How do you handle that?
I was right there.
How do you handle that when your folks are going through problems like that?
Like every other kid. You try and help. You try and be there. You don't talk about it outside the house. None of us did. And you just try and be there.
Do you remember the first time you saw The Wizard of Oz?
No, I really don't. I remember I introduced it.
On television?
Yeah, the first time it was shown. And
you came on before the movie and talked a little about it.
Yeah, I talked to Bert Lahr. And I was sitting at his feet.
The Cowardly Lion?
Yes. It was so sweet. And we had a script. But in those days, what you did, you had to do it twice, one for New York Time and one for L.A. Time. And I blew a line. And Bert Lahr said, "Don't you want to ask me?" And I said, "Yes," or something. And he asked me, it was fine, and I went home. So I didn't watch it. I think I saw it again in a big theater, but I can't remember. Because it frightened me. There was this little girl who I didn't know.
Yeah, did you relate to her at all?
No.
That was your mother?
No. Had nothing to do with my... It was this little girl. And these monkeys flew away with her. It just... I didn't like it. Spooky.
Oh, we're off to see the wizard, the wonderful wizard.
Then I saw it, of course, much later. And I thought, how the hell did they do that?
Yeah.
And I found out there were five directors. It took years to make. And I got interested in the process. Yeah.
Enchanting movie.
Yes.
Do you have a favorite movie of your mother's and of your dad's?
Oh, that's tough. Well, I'm sitting here because of Meet Me in St. Louis, so
right.
I have to say that.
Right. Because it's the one that brought them together for the first time.
Yes.
The moment I saw him smile, was just my style. My only regret is we've never met, though I dream of him all the while.
When Arthur Freed brought Daddy in and said, "Mr. Minnelli wants to make a movie," and Mary looked at him and said, "What's it about?" Daddy said, "Nothing." I just started to jangle the change in his pockets. He said, no. He said, "Oh, no, it's about a family. And the father gets a job in New York." I said, "Oh, so they moved to New York." "No." I just said, "It's great. It'll be fine." So he's the first one to really make impressions, moments that you remember.
It's a wonderful movie.
Sure is.
Yes. Now, you did a show in honor of your father on Broadway, Minnelli and Minnelli, which was a big success for you.
Yes.
Done at the Palace. Wonderful show.
Thank you.
You've never really done one on your mother. Is there a particular reason for that?
Well, I haven't done it yet. When I can think of the right way to do it and to say what I want to say, which is, first of all, to not be maudlin, and second of all, to be completely honest and truthful, I'll figure it out. So, we'll have to wait and see.
What do you miss most about your father?
his support. Just my father. He helped me with every film that I did up until he died. A lot in Cabaret. A lot in The Stroh Cuckoo. A lot.
Now, near the end of his life, he directed you in a movie. A Matter of
yes.
Time.
Oh, just let a woman get past 50 and she is nothing, right? Gone. Finished. Get rid of her. Kick her out. Send her off to an asylum where they can star her to death or beat her up every day.
What was that process like, having your father direct you in a film?
It was interesting. It was also difficult because he was starting to get a form of dementia. So he couldn't explain what he really wanted. And I couldn't, it was hard to communicate with him. So I did the best I could. And then the people who edited it, you know, made it into a different film than he wrote. So it was tough. Yeah.
That's a film that's pretty much disappeared.
Yeah.
With Ingrid Bergman, Charles Boyer,
yeah.
Isabella Rossellini, great cast.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Tell a little about the night you won the Oscar for Cabaret. Your dad was there with you.
Oh, yeah.
That must have meant an awful lot to have him at your side
for
that.
And you know, he was so quiet, but he was so tense that, you know, I could feel him shaking. And when Diana Ross, who had just presented the Oscar to somebody, sat down, I noticed that she had changed her outfit. She was in this beautiful new outfit. I thought, well, that's it.
Because she was up for the Oscar that year for Lady Sings the Blues,
right? I thought, that's it. She knows. Well. And they said, Liza Minnelli, my father yelled in my ear so badly, he gave me a condition called tinnitus.
Seriously?
Seriously. I still have it. It's ringing in the ear. It's a true thing.
So your dad's still with you? In
and
a
I'll
strange
say,
way, yes.
Oh, it was hilarious.
Now, you know, of course, you're the only Oscar winner that has a mother and a father that both won Oscars.
I know it.
Yeah, that's it.
That's when one of my dogs is named Oscar.
Yeah, that's great for the history books. You performed with your mother at the Palladium. Talk just a little about that. The experience of performing with your mother.
She said, I want you to come and do the Palladium with me. And I said, no. She said, oh, please. I said, for God's sake, Mama, get, you know, Frank or Dean or Peggy Lee. There's all these people. She said, I know, I want you. I said, all right. I said, but if I'm going to do it, Mom, I'm going to do it my own way. She said, okay. I'm coming on, but you have to sing 5 songs first. Or I'm not going on. She said, really? I said, yeah. She said, okay. I said, I'm going to come on and sing 5 songs. Okay. I said, then we'll close the first act together. She said, well, what do we sing? We don't have any music. I said, you have all that music from your TV shows. We'll find something. We'll put something together. All right. I said, fine. I said, now the second act, and I wrote, you know, where she sings Liza, you know, to get back on and to get us together. Second act, fine. We wrote it all out. Everything's great. So now, I meet Chris and Peter Allen. Well, Peter and I immediately get along. Immediately. And he's starting to change certain things musically for me that are better. In my own stuff. Then with duets with Mama, he's giving me notes that are better for me, for harmonies for her. Because I can hit certain things that'll give her a better note and sound better for me. So it's all going fine. So we do it, and they go nuts. I come on, and I'm singing, and I look in the wings, and after the first song, they're so surprised that I'm any good at all, that they're like, I see my mother look out from the wings. She goes, yeah, baby, yeah, yeah, yeah. Second song, they go even more nuts. Yeah, baby, that's it. Third song, that's it. Get 'em, girl, get 'em. Fourth song, she's going, uh-huh. Fifth song, she's putting on her lipstick again, I think. And Judy Garland walked back on the stage. What's her mama? I thought, oh, Christ, shit. You know, just keep up. There was no rehearsal for choreography. So wherever she went, I kept up. I just kept up. That's what I did. It was frightening. Let me tell you something. It was frightening, but it was also fun.
Yeah.
It was fun. We had a good time afterwards.
What do you miss most about your mother?
Oh, her humor. You know? And your support. Most of my parents, I'm like everybody else who's lost their parents.
Yeah.
Yeah. They were great.
One thing you've also said that I just want to bring up is that we're talking about you and your support that you got, that your fans never have given up on you. They've always stuck by you. How meaningful that is.
Oh, yeah, that's wonderful. But, because I think they know I'll come through. I won't do if I can't come through.
You once said something that I thought was so smart. You said that your great talent, you felt, was knowing who the best people were, and you got to know them, and you learned from them.
Yes. Everything but business.
And investments.
Yes.
Yes.
Ah, mamma mia, che cazzo.
What's the best thing about being Liza Minnelli?
I guess the gift of curiosity I was given. So that I wake up and I think, oh, I wonder what I'm going to learn today. To have that is really something.
Is that from your father, mainly?
I think it's from both of them. And it's from the people I've known in my life. You know? Like the Gershwins, Kay Thompson, Ira, all these directors, everyone, you.
What's the toughest part of being Liza Minnelli?
The assumptions that people make. But that's okay. I mean, it's not really, but it has to be.
Not much one can do about it. But that's one reason I was so looking forward to sitting down and doing this, to show a side of Liza Minnelli that I know.
Yeah.
That for people to see what you're like, how thoughtful you are, caring you are.
Thank you.
How bright you are.
Thank you.
And interested in everything. Because I don't think a lot of people that read about you or just see you perform maybe get that picture of you.
Oh, thank you, Robert.
Thank you.
Thank you, my darling.
I just thank you so much, and I wish you Godspeed and all good things.
Want to dance?
Sure. Let's go. Thank you.
I love you.
That linger to only fade anew.
soft and fleeting, gently repeat.